Hello and welcome to Berks Business. I'm Bob Wert, Managing Director for Investments of the Wert Investment Consulting Group of Wells Fargo Advisors. Each month on Berks Business, we give you the opportunity to meet the leaders of the regional business community. And tonight, we bring Tim Hetrich, who is a teacher at the Wyomissing School District, teaching about economic education. And Tim, you brought a couple students with you.
I have. I will let them, Bob, though, introduce themselves. Amy?
Hi, I'm Amy. I'm in Mr. Hetrich's Honors Economic class.
I'm James Cardi, and I'm in Mr. Hetrich's AP Micro class.
Super. Okay, so tonight we're going to be talking in the first half of the program about economic education and a little bit about what goes on in the Wyomissing School District. Kind of interesting, just learning about skills for life and also about how things work in marketplaces. Second part of the program, we'll be talking about the stock market game, which is an economic simulation conducted at both the high school and college level, and Mr. Hetrich's teams have been among the finest in the nation in previous contests. So we'll see if he can keep up that good record. So let's start out with talking a little bit about economic education.
Sure, Bob.
What do you teach?
By the way, thank you for the plug. That's a lot of pressure. However, semester by semester, we've had a lot of success in the stock markets. I teach a wide range of economics, though, as you saw with some of my students who are here tonight. In our academic sense, it's more of a consumerism class. The day-to-day needs of, you know, how to budget your money, how to invest that money, the importance of being fiscally conservative with your money and making sure that you have something for your goals later in life. The honors academic, economics class that Amy just started this semester is much of the same, but a lot more taste of college, what a college economics class would be like, with just a tasting of microeconomics as well as macroeconomics. James, as you heard, is in my AP, Advanced Placement, micro, as well as macroeconomics class. We cover a lot of territory. I think James might want to comment on that a little bit later on in the show. And that really has very little to do with economic illiteracy, Bob. That's really more preparing my students for what a college micro class, a college macroeconomics class is going to be. And that curriculum is not set so much by me or the Wyomissing Area School District. It's set by the College Board, the Educational Testing Service.
So let's go into that. What's the distinction between AP and honors and academic?
Well, I can only speak for Wyomissing. In my little world of Wyomissing, academic is preparing our students for the real world. The difference between micro, macroeconomics, budgeting, investment. I think gone is the day of my day or your grandmother's day when savings account was, a passbook savings account was your only investment option. Our kids need to be far more savvy than that today. They have so much power with the internet, with their smartphones in front of them. They need to be just as savvy with the content of how what they do with their money and how they budget it. That's our academic economics class. The honors economics class certainly keeps some of that component because there's some really valuable life skills that are there that I want to keep. But these are a lot of students also who, you know, are going to be taking a college economics class and need to know a little bit more of the nuts and bolts of the economy, how a business operates, as well as the larger economy. James's class, which is advanced placement, we happen to teach at Wyomissing, and one of the only schools in the state, if not the nation, teaches both an AP micro and an AP macro all in 1 year. It's a heavy lift. And that's all theoretical economics, theoretical micro, the theory of the firm, cost curves, how they determine their costs, as well as how a business operates in the macro economy, the larger world, and now really more of a world vision as well, not just a national.
So James, tell us a little bit about what you've learned with respect to micro and macro.
I learned what I always talked about how supply and demand works and how the cost curves affect a business. Now we're learning about GDP and how it's calculated and how to like increase the GDP, how depreciation affects the economy, and that's about it.
Yeah, we just started the GDP analysis. We just started the macro, just like Amy started 2 weeks ago, and honors economics, James just started. We just folded over from the micro concepts to the macro. Now let's look at the big economy, all businesses put together.
Amy, what are you focusing on?
Right now, for instance, today we discussed the supply and demand and how the price is affected by if a certain supply is needed and the demand is up or down, how the price varies. and scarcity in the economy. And we just learn about the stock market and what bonds are and what stocks are and just the basics of how the economy works.
Actually, that might be helpful for our audience because our audience is kind of a general audience. Tell us about stocks. Tell us about bonds. What are they? How do they work?
Talk about putting Amy right on the spot.
Not a problem.
Stocks, you can invest in them. There's the bear market and the bull market. Mm-hmm. The bear market is described kind of like as a slow-moving kind of just a slow market. And the bull market is always changing. It's fast-paced. We learn about the difference of those. What else?
And stock valuations reflecting that, looking at the various indicators, the Dow, the Russell. So we've just begun scratching the surface with Amy. I felt badly about putting you on the spot like that.
That's
thank
right.
you, Mr. Wert.
But it's interesting. And when you look at a bull market is considered one where stocks are rising and bear market when they're falling. It's, that's mm-hmm. why it's all, a bear is considered a bad thing. Mm-hmm. And yet that's also a time when you get your opportunities.
We did talk about that. The difference, I said, is a bear market. And once we identified what those market issues were, is that a bad market? And all the kids are like, yeah, that's a bad market. I said, look at you as a young investor. Prices are down. You've got some bargain basement prices on some great national and international, regional, national, international mm-hmm. companies. What an opportunity. And the kids stopped and thought, we never thought of that before. A bear market for a young investor, or even an older investor like myself, is nothing more than an opportunity to get into the market. If you can do with some research, the opposite of what everyone else is doing, you have a great deal of opportunity to make some savvy investments.
Yeah, if you're patient and not easily rattled, it helps.
Exactly.
That works out well. So talking about economic education, some of the other aspects that you're talking about in your classes are things like credit history. Why
yes.
is that important?
Well, so much of our students, you know, I'm dealing with 17 and 18-year-old students who, for the most part, are seniors and getting ready to go out into the real world. And probably in 4 or 5 short years, we'll be entering into the labor market themselves with hopefully some really high-end labor skills. They need to be savvy enough to be able to understand the responsibility that they have to the businesses that they've incurred debt to, such as paying their bills on time and in full. We talk about that in a great deal in academic economics. And how to build that credit history, which goes into building that credit score. Because in a lot of ways, my students to the right of me are looking at 3-digit numbers to get them into the right colleges or the colleges of their choice. And in just a few short years, they're going to be looking at another 3-digit number known as a credit score, which is going to either open a lot of opportunities, not only in lending at various rates, mm-hmm. but also some employment opportunities, because employers are looking at you and they're really picking up a lot of information on a, evidently a very shallow score, but from that shallow score goes a lot of history.
Sure. So what goes into that that a student can affect at this point?
Well, tell them the best thing you can do, if I can go back to a savings account or a checking account, is open a checking account, open a savings account. You're now on the grid. Businesses have ways of evaluating you. You understand what it means to put money into a bank, to balance a bank account, balance your savings account, balance your checking account. Beyond that, I tell them, believe it or not, it's maybe seemingly a heretical a statement, is somewhat like a heretic, but get a credit card. Mm-hmm. Get a credit card with a fairly low balance on it. Don't go over 60% of that maximum. And make sure that when that bill comes in, you're writing that check, even if it hurts, even if you're grimacing, you're writing that check in full, and you're making sure it gets to that business, not the day they want to do, but several days if you're using snail mail.
Right.
If it's online, then you can do it the day of.
Exactly. So, James, you've learned a few things in class. Have you applied that also in the real world?
I don't know if any, a lot of the things that we've learned in class really apply.
You're talking about some investing success that you've had.
Yeah. I don't know if they apply so much to me and my personal finances, but for businesses and stuff like that, they certainly do.
Mm-hmm.
But
so what's the most useful thing you've learned?
Just don't give up and just keep trying, because if you stop and just give up, then you fail. And if you keep persevere and just keep going, you'll end up succeeding.
Okay. Amy, same question. What's the most useful thing you've learned?
That there are so many opportunities, how you can learn from the stock market and how it can change your life when you're investing or when you have bonds. Like, there are so many other ways to earn money other than a career. Mm-hmm. And I think that's important for students to know, that just because they have stocks that they can get money or they can also lose money. And it's important to know how that works.
Bob, if I could just piggyback on that, I tell my students, and maybe it's too harsh of a reality, that they're all going to go out, I'm sure, and get good jobs. Those 9-to-5 jobs, they're probably going to have, because of the type of student that I deal with on a daily basis, they're hardworking to focus kids, they're intelligent kids, they come from really good family backgrounds and a great school district. They're going to get great jobs. But those jobs are good for paying the bills. Money income coming in is money that you're going to write on the monthly bills that come in, whether that be a mortgage, a rent, a credit card bill, the heating, water, sewage, lighting, and all that kind of stuff. That if they want to build wealth in their life, they have to find some vehicle other than just working the 9-to-5 job mm-hmm. to build wealth, whether that's in real estate, whether that's in finance. Whatever that might be, they have to find something they're comfortable with, they're knowledgeable about, and as James said, that you stay with over the long haul. If you have patience, you're going to be successful.
One of the interesting things about investment, it forces you to be a student of life.
Yeah.
To be a student of what's going on in the world around you so that you can apply that to your investment decisions. So
exactly.
Let's take a moment to do a break for Berks Community Television, and we'll learn a little bit more about what's going on with BCTV.
You're watching Berks Business on bctv.org. Be informed, be involved, be a member. For membership information, go to www.bctv.org/support/membership. To read other stories concerning local businesses, go to www.bctv.org.
I'd also like to thank the Berks Career and Technology Center for being a sponsor of Berks Business. All right, let's talk a little bit about the stock market game, which is an economic simulation that's done both in high school and in college, giving students the opportunity to have a trial portfolio for about 10 weeks. They can go long, they can go short, they can do all sorts of interesting things. Let's talk a little bit about that, and what do you learn from that?
Sure, Bob. I love opportunities in my classroom where I can take, and my students can take, things that they learn in my classroom or in any classroom and apply it to real world scenarios. And that's exactly what the Pennsylvania and national stock market game are all about. As you said, it is a 10-week trial period, which automatically makes them short-term speculators as
right.
opposed to long-term investors. But that's the nature of the game. They understand, you know, it's a sprint, not a long-distance race. I've been doing the Pennsylvania stock market game as well as the New Jersey stock market game for about 26 or more years now. And as you said, we've had a lot of success. My students have had the success taking some of the principles they've learned and then begin doing the research, understanding what a balance sheet might look like for a business, mm-hmm. What a PE ratio, some of those major things, or some of those things you want to look at that individually don't necessarily indicate a good investment, but put together like pieces of a puzzle, begin to tell you about companies and their position in their community. It's been a great opportunity for my students to get a fictitious $100,000 of cash and begin investing that into the real companies in the real stock exchange, principally in New York, Amex, as well as NASDAQ. And there they can begin seeing and perceiving how microeconomic tendencies of the firm against the backdrop of the national and international economies really begin to buffet, either buoy or sink, the valuation of the company. So there's a lot of things that are confluencing together in the game.
So James, you've had some time to study this. What research skills do you bring to bear, and what are you looking for?
I've just looked at stuff you talked about. I've pretty much know about that stuff just from personal research and stuff like that. And I just go around and try to find stocks that have performed well in the past. And if they do meet certain things that I look for, then I become interested in them and maybe buy them.
So you're looking at the history of the company mm-hmm. as much as anything.
Yep.
And both from a performance standpoint and from any other point?
I look at technical stuff sometimes. They're in upward wedges, downward wedges, head and shoulders, just golden crosses, all that kind of stuff.
Oh, the old technical analysis.
Yeah.
Okay. As a Chicago alumni, I could have some words, but we can discuss that a little bit because there's some folks swear by it and some people don't. I think the exact opposite, more of a random walk-up kind of approach. We'll get to that. So let's talk a little bit about, you have a 10-week time, you have $100,000.
Yes.
What strategies make the most sense for a team to employ?
Volatility is the key. whether it's a long position or a short position, volatility is nothing more than an opportunity to make money on the upward side or even possibly a downward side, as in the bear market of 2009-10. So volatility is really key in catching that stock at the right point in a very short 10-week sprint.
So in a 10-week sprint, you're doing the exact opposite of what a real-world investor would do.
Yeah, there's the difference between in the real world, this is what you want to do as far as a stock portfolio in a long position. What we're kind of training them to do in the stock market is to go against some of those really important principles of hold quality stocks. The stock market game, you know, there's a time horizon. We're not talking about 10 years, we're talking about 10 weeks. And so the strategy has to change in accordance with the rules of the game.
Exactly. James, you want to say something? Chomping at the bit.
No, I don't mean to leave Amy out of this. We're a little bit hamstrung tonight. There's some of my economic students who, their semester has ended, so all of those students have now moved on, and I would really have loved to pull in the value that they brought out of the game, their personal experiences over 10 weeks. We're not meaning to leave Amy out of this discussion. She has not really gotten there yet.
So that's something you're looking forward to getting into.
The game will begin February 28th, so we've got about 3 weeks yet until that game begins. That gives me enough time to get through the nuts and bolts of terminology and strategy so that they can hit the ground running with the internet and the computers in my room.
So in the real world, you would have a diversified portfolio with lots and lots of holdings. In the game, you would do the exact opposite. Why?
The minimum, just the antithesis of diversification is choose two companies. You want to catch that bounce.
Right.
So you want to obviously invest the majority of your money in those growth stocks that are going to grow in a very short period of time so you see the greatest valuation. The team with the greatest portfolio value at the end of the 10-week period in the first week of May, when on Friday, whenever May 7th, whenever that ends, the team with the greatest portfolio cash value is deemed the winner.
Now, in 2009, you used a somewhat different strategy.
We did. we used a short position. I won't go into that, but we were doing something that some people might think was not a good thing to do. We were rooting against the market, especially the financial sector. Excuse me. And that was my advice to my students at that time in honors in academic economics was, let's borrow. We used a couple of, I won't use any of the names, let's borrow some bank stocks and buy them back at a future date at a lesser value.
Right.
So we were able to cash in on a position that the stocks were worth in October and buy them back in early December at a much lower rate. And of course, what was left over, the residual, was their cash portfolio, and that left them as the number one team in the nation. In the fall of 2009, based on shorting the financial markets.
So let's talk to the students about, research has changed quite a bit from the time that your teacher and I went to school, and the internet's come along and there's been many other tools. What sort of things do you look for when you're handed a white sheet of paper and you're given a problem and you're told, okay, go research information? How do you go about doing that?
I just use Google.
Okay.
For the most part.
Google Finance is a great
Just Google Finance.
That's what I use.
Okay, and any other tools beyond that, or is that?
I use Yahoo sometimes if I want to see like some of the major, the 20-day moving averages are.
Okay.
Or stuff like that. But other than that, mostly just Google.
Okay, Amy.
I would probably use any search engine on the internet. I think the internet is really helpful, especially with the stocks and looking up how stock is doing and to see how they were doing in the past as well. I think the internet is definitely really useful.
Okay. And you can also go look at the company's websites themselves.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I don't know if you've done that yet, probably not.
Not yet, we haven't.
Okay.
The one thing my students do reflect, the internet is a very powerful mechanism, obviously, but the one reflection with my students is, wow, where do we begin? There's just so much information. How do we sift through it?
Right.
And that's always my side vent. Then you really want a good financial planner on your side, guiding you through this. I tell them, if you've got, you know, your appendix is burst, you've got a pain down here radiating on the left side, I don't know that you're the right person to do the appendectomy, even if you read about it. Right. You want to go to a professional to get that guidance. And I think that's also a very powerful message. Mm-hmm. Students can do research on their own. They can learn about businesses and the environment in which they operate. But they also want to have somebody that they trust, somebody that they know, somebody who's a professional to give them some sage words of advice along the way, too, and advice.
An informed client makes a better client.
Yeah, absolutely.
So. Well, let's talk a little bit about how do you discern when you're doing research what's good information and what's not? Because there's so much out there on the internet, and you can go to Google and you can go to these other fine search engines, but then you get the results. What do you look at to discern whether or not it's real information or maybe not so much?
That's a tough question. I tell my students one of the biggest pieces of information you should look at is, do you know the company? Mm-hmm. Do you like the company? Do you know the company's strategy? Do you know they know Apple? Oh, Apple must be a good stock. Okay, let's start. Well, James is shaking his head now.
I didn't really want to talk about any particular stock, but B, I mean,
right.
Sometimes a fine company can be an awful stock and vice versa. Not referring to that particular company, but just as a general concept.
Exactly.
And there are other times when an awful company can be a fine stock if it's cheap enough.
Mm-hmm. You're right.
And it makes it interesting, because you just don't know what to expect. You look at the way the world perceives a company, and sometimes they miss things. Mm-hmm. And a lot of times, when you look at markets, they're driven as much by emotion as anything else, which drives the supply and demand.
Absolutely.
Which is something, supply and demand is something you've learned about. And have you talked yet about the factors that drive supply and demand?
Well, today, for instance, in class, we learned that really only like four or five things are actually free in this world, and how even things that come to your mind that you think are free, in some way, someone's making money off of it. And for example, someone in my class today said that oxygen was free, when really, if you have a heart attack, that's not free.
Right.
Somebody also said education was free.
Yeah.
Really? Okay, let's talk about that as college, you know, preparatory students. Is it free? And we talked about there is no such thing as
the proverbial Milton Friedman is there is no such thing as a free lunch.
Correct.
Somebody paid for it.
Yeah.
So, and that's a true statement, because no matter what's out there, the consumer might not be paying the cost, but there's a cost to be paid. So finishing up in the last minute or so we have left, let's talk about your upcoming simulation and your groups. How many classes do you have? How many students are involved? That sort of thing.
I have one last class. That's Amy's class. It's my honors economics. We'll probably be breaking into teams tomorrow, seeing as later this week might be another snowstorm coming. So
yes.
I'll make sure that they are registered by midweek. So tomorrow I'll be saying, okay, who wants to team up? We're not yet there, but I'd rather have 3 weeks for them to think about their teams and begin getting some strategies in the midst of what my notes happen to be.
And so they're, even though they're just getting started, when it gets to that point, they're already thinking about how to put information to work.
And how to work together, which is really important. It's a team effort. They become like the board of directors of any investment company. That's their job, to work together. So that's an important dynamic coming together as well.
Oh, absolutely. So whenever you're thrown into a team, is it going to be a team of your choosing, or is it a team that's chosen?
I always allow them to choose their own team.
Okay.
I'm not big into that arranged marriage. They can choose their own partners.
Fair enough.
But I tell them there's important there, choose well.
That's exactly right. That's exactly right. We'll save that lesson for another day. Our guest has been Tim Hetrich, who's a teacher at the Wyomissing School District, and two of his students, Amy Alderfer and James Cardi. I'm Bob Wert, Managing Director for Investments of the Wert Investment Consulting Group of Wells Fargo Advisors. Thank you for joining us in Berks Business, and we'll see you again the second Monday of next month.